to this webinar. It is all about you. Why this title, all about you? I assume that the participants of this webinar are women who are either professionals or business women or in some employment in some way. And I understand also that there are young ladies who are participants here who will soon enter into their own careers. Now, you're welcome. The central purpose to bring to focus factors that will help or hinder your career. This is the purpose of this seminar, this webinar. The webinar will not, or I will not be deal with universal career issues like which profession is hot at this moment or which companies are, you know, looking for what type of people and what career that you can make there. What are the pluses and minuses and what are the you know, issues of the bosses or none of these things, because they are general issues. What we will be dealing today is very gender specific issues, and that too in an Indian context. What I'm about to share is not any new findings, but only ideas and issues that we need to bring into our conscious awareness, and we need to deal with them. Let me put a small disclaimer here. I'll be taking a generally acceptable or applicable view from a majority people, a majority of people perspective. That means what applies to the large majority. I am very aware that each of you are uniquely wonderful persons and you have very unique background and you are in very special situations. That is not replicable. So you will have to analyze what I'm saying and make it, you know, suitable for you and your situation. Now that's why I call this, it is all about you, you the singular wonderful person. Now you would be wondering, what makes me qualified to talk to you on this subject? I mean, this is a, in all ways, this is a gender specific, and here I am, a male, talking about this. My 40 years of wonderful corporate and NGO experience has certain limited value. What is more relevant is this. All the people who were influential in my life have been women. My mentor and guide is a woman. She still lives in the US. She's 92. I had a wonderful female boss and colleagues. Most important, I have three career women at home. Now from all these people, after observing this, observing them, and I have learned to appreciate their capabilities, their women's capabilities, their pain. I have appreciated their successes and appreciated their where they had difficulties and failures. So I have been able to learn much from them. Now, let us define and understand what is a career. What do we mean by career? Now, career is a long-term engagement in any area that brings in additional responsibility, additional authority, and higher remuneration. I repeat, a career is when you look for additional responsibility, additional authority, and of course higher remuneration. Now, when you are looking for all this, this is your career. If this is so, my first question to you is, what is the most critical factor that will affect your career? Unfortunately, you cannot give me an answer right now. You will have to, it doesn't permit at the moment question and answers. But keep in your mind, don't lose this. What is the most critical factor that will affect your career? If somebody is in line with my answer, my thinking, you can indicate it later. The answer that I have is this. It's your husband. Now, here I have made the assumption that 99% of you are already married or intends to get married. Let us leave that 1% at this moment. At question hour time, probably we can deal with that 1% later. Yes, your husband is or will be the most crucial or critical factor in your career. Now, why do I say this? Probably you agree with me, but still, let me back it up with one very significant data. When they took the 26 women CEO of Fortune 500 companies, this is the largest in the world, the Fortune 500, 24 of them were married, and they, without exception, stated that the most important factor for their success was their husbands. The husbands, they said, supported them emotionally, took care of children, and took part in the home chores. Now, it can be vice versa also. Your husband can be a limiting factor. Also, in an Indian context, it's not only the husband, it could be his family or your family. It happens. But still, the main factor will still remain your husband. My recommendation in this context is this. If you intend to get married or intend to get married, perhaps you need to talk to him, your husband-to-be, about your career plans, and see if they gel. You know, that will ease things a whole lot. So that, you know, you both start off on the same platform, and he knows where to come in and support you, what are your expectations, and it will ease your whole lot. If you're already married and have not discussed your career aspirations, it may be a good idea to talk about it in terms of what are your possibilities, what you can do, what it can bring into the family and to you and to him and to the you know, the whole picture, and what are the plans that you have to make that happen. Now, this is the starting point, I would say, as in your career, and it will continue to be the main factor that pushes you forward, or has the power to pull you back into the in your career. The second most important question before you will be, how far do you want to go? This is a personal assessment that you have to make. When her big boss, an expatriate, asked our second daughter, what is her ambition? She said that in a span of 10 years, she would like to occupy his office. He said he's surprised, and especially coming from an Indian girl. Now, these are cultural roles, cultural stereotypes that exist, which you have to deal with. People may or may not appreciate that you have to these ambitions. The point here is that you have to make an assessment of your strengths, weaknesses, your potential, your possibilities in your field, and decide where you want to be. I have seen many women limiting themselves. Now let me make it very clear at this moment. I am not making a value judgment here. Each of you must make that choice, and what you make is the right choice. If you feel that my career stops here, please do, because I know there will be many factors that limit you to that. There will be people who make the choice that my family is important, I do not want a career move. Good, I respect that and appreciate it also. But all I am saying is that each of you must make your choice. Simply ask yourself if you have considered all the factors, and then go ahead and take your call. You are right. Now, Susan, my wife, was a professor in a college, and she intended, and she was qualified to be the, she was trying to be qualified to be the principal. But she did not push it forward. I am guilty of staying neutral. I did not push her either, thinking that it will be difficult for her to handle admin and you know, the external factors that may come in, and you know, the problems that you have to deal with. I wasn't sure that she'll be able to handle all that. But later she headed another institution, and I was pleasantly surprised to see how well she handled the job, the external factors, the administration, and everything. What I'm saying is, sometimes we fail to take the total picture, like we did. Now, let me bring one more example on, you know, what are possibilities, just for you to consider. Recently, I was one of the jury to select the distinguished alumni of a business school. Almost all of us agreed that pinpointed one lady alumni as the most distinguished, taking all the criteria kept into focus. She had climbed to the top of an MNC in the US. She's the first woman to do so, and also the first Indian to do so. Now, if this was all her credibility, then I don't think we would have selected her as the most distinguished, because there were other people who had climbed even higher. But she did it with two children and two bouts of cancer. And she's still battling the cancer, and she's still in her career. Now, it is, as I said, it is all about you. You have to decide where you want to go and how you will go about it. Do not limit yourself with expectations, but take a proper assessment of where you are, what you are, and where you want to go, and then decide your decision is right. The next important question, that a gender question that you will face, is this: when should I have my baby? Or what about my children? Women become acutely aware of this biological factor, and that has an effect on your career. You know, Sheryl Sandberg, of Facebook, she's CEO of Facebook. Sheryl cites this in her book, Lean In. Now, this is an exceptionally good book. I think all of you should read Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg, CEO of Facebook. She talks about a five-year-old girl. You know, this girl comes home, and her mother noticed that she's a little down and asked, "Baby, what's happening? Why you are looking so glum?" She said, "Okay, now this girl has a crush on one boy, and his name is Ken. And she says that, Mama, you know, I want to be an astronaut." I said, "Yeah, good. Now, Ken also wants to be an astronaut." "Okay, very good. So what's wrong?" She says, "Like, if Ken goes to the space and I also go to space, who's going to look after the children?" You know, very early, at 5 years or time, you become acutely aware that you need to take care of the children. This is something a man does not face. You know, you also are worried about the childbearing age, what happens at that particular time, and, you know, when should I have my baby? Should I wait more, or should I jump in something? Now, let me say about our elder daughter. She was doing her PG in gynecology when she became pregnant. We were a little upset about that, but we said, "Don't worry, go ahead, we'll support you." Her mother took 6 months leave, went and stayed with her, and in the PG hostel and cooking and supporting her. And she actually wrote her exam on full term. A couple of days later, she delivered. Now, these are the travails of a woman who needs to understand how her career will have to mesh with these factors. Now, who are the two critical people in your life at this stage? You know, this is a wonderful thing. Your mother and mother-in-law. Now, these are from, you know, God-given gifts. And our, especially in our Indian context, they are gifts to a career woman. Let me illustrate. My friend's daughter is a top-notch executive in one of the well-known companies in India. She has three children, and she has reached the top just because her mother and her mother-in-law rotated and to be at home when she did progressed in her career. The point I'm trying to make is that you all may not have, you know, all this what I'm talking about, but you need to build a support system back home. You may have a good relationship with your boss and a still better relationship with your colleagues. But unless you have a good relationship built at home to support you, I will even venture to say that your career is not in a strong position. So take care. Take care to keep a good relationship as a good backup at home, because without that, it will be very difficult for you to concentrate on your career, take all the opportunities that comes your way, so your home is intact. This is so much important in an Indian context, especially. We have then the eternal question. Can I have it all, or can I have the best of both worlds, career and home? I don't know whether you remember, perhaps a year back, Indira Nui of Pepsi, she made a statement that, to the effect that, not exactly maybe, but that you cannot have the best of both worlds. Oh, that statement went viral. She received a lot of flack for saying that, and a lot of support for saying that also. You know, our experience, my own personal, my wife and I, our own experience is that it needs compromises. Actually, it's a simple economic sense. It's a trade-off. We make the best of, we trade. There is a cost of everything. See, whether we have, either we can do, for example, you can go for exercise, or you can relax at home. You cannot both relax and exercise. There is, it can be either with the family or with the friends or in the office. See, what I would say is that One big myth is the superwoman. Let me make it very clear. I think that a woman is a wonderful manager. She is by nature a great manager. But to say that you can be a superwoman or a supermom is a myth. It just does not happen. So you have to make your compromises and go forward. Let me take Susan, my wife, gave up her PhD work when she perceived that her girls needed her time and at home. So she gave it up. And her part of her career, this one also with that. But that's the choice that you have to make. You cannot make both. There's only one major issue here, which you need to also guard, is that the problem that Susan has, that she starts feeling guilty when either one is compromised. Oh, I couldn't do that in the work, or something goes wrong, or not well done at home. My major work with her was there to assuage her guilt feeling. I encourage you to accept the compromises which are necessary at home and in the working situation. And stop hearing any voice that says that you have failed, you are not capable, you are a failure. Please ask the voice to shut up. You cannot be perfect. Do not try to be perfect. Let there be the compromise. That will work. There will be times when everything doesn't fit in. Ever sometimes goes on, it's all right. You can still be there. Don't worry about your children. So sometimes in the health problem, will you believe that Sheryl Sandberg says in a book that she found this, the hair bleaches in her daughter's hair. Sheryl Sandberg. So it happens. You don't worry about making compromises, but if you take both home. Now there is one more important thing that I'm saying that we need to start work. You probably have maids at home to support you, and you will be training her. But I would say, go ahead and train your husband more than the maid. My generation of males are the lucky ones who were kept out of the kitchen. See, basically women are guilty of what they do is called maternal gatekeeping. They prevent the male to come into the kitchen, probably because of our cultural roles, or that because men make a mess. Now, I'm in the second category. If I try to get in the kitchen, and after some time she'll say, no, just get up, let me do it myself. Now, I will very happily go sit in front of the TV and watch cricket. But that's not right. I don't think she really helped me in that. I help your husband to do the chores in the kitchen, share some of the responsibilities like homework with the kids, or whatever other things, or projects, or whatever other things that she will have to do. Now, there was always the question like, who will get up at night when the baby cries? You know, one day I said, I have a presentation in the morning. She said, I too have a meeting in the morning. Now, who will get up? I must confess that there is more often that Susan got up than I did. But we need to modify these cultural roles and we need to have more partners. There is one thing, but this may take a little time. This may, I'm not saying that this will happen, but I will there is one thing that you can do, which is within your capacity, that is preparing the next generation. Teach your son to have an equal role. Teach him the life skills needed. For God's sake, please do not make him a king of all that he surveys. And all the sisters and maidens, attend to him like a king. For God's sake, don't do it. Bring him down to Mother Earth, that he is as good or as bad as your daughter, and they are on equal terms. Both of them get the same work, the same course. Now, so far we have dealt with factors that are out of your work area. We talked about things that you need to be, or factors that we need to consider to organize yourself for your career. How to get things organized there. Now let's look at what happens. Some of the things that you need to be consciously aware of. What happens on the job? At the job front, women sit back, hold back, and stay back. This is by default, I have seen this happening. You know, our elder daughter is a gynecologist. Even in an area which is an exclusive women concerned like gynecology, men try to dominate. She literally had to stand up and fight for her rights very sweetly. It's enormous pressure because you want to state what you want to say. At the same time, be light. That adds a lot of pressure. Traditionally, by nature, women hold back. Are you aware that you're holding back? In my office, whenever I have a meeting, the guys will come and occupy the four chairs in front of my table, and the ladies will come and sit at the back. Please do not do that. Please sit where you are entitled. You know, when you have a large meeting on a boardroom type of meeting, when we have, where do we find the woman? We find him at the end of the table. And they hesitate to give a suggestion or say something until you are asked. Please be aware of this, that you are limiting at these particular stages. Whenever there is an opportunity, women hesitate. Like for example, if there is a project coming up or if there is an opportunity to do something, some analysis and presentations and all that, and says openly, who's going to do it? Women hesitate. And the men jump. They jump to take that. Are you aware of this? Please be aware of this. Please do not hold back. By all means, take stock. But do not let an opportunity go by. You know, also, I have noticed that, you know, when an assessment comes from all over, I look at the PMS, the performance management system, it passes through my desk. And I see women generally try to rate themselves lower than men. Men try to put their performance much higher than what actually is. But women will not do that. They tend to hold a little back. I would rather say that please do not hold back. Put whatever is there, assess it well, and put it there. And let the others take their view of whether it is right, whether it is wrong. Also, I have noticed that sometimes women hesitate to take leadership roles because they feel that they may not be liked, that they have to be harsh and, you know, that's something that they dread and they may not be liked. But that's not true. That's not true. You still can hold your positional leadership and keep your relationship also. I have seen my wife holding a leadership position for years. There has been moments of friction, even with men. But women have an advantage of that innate caring tendency. And that brings the relationship and keeps the relationship strong. Actually, there were more accolades for my wife when on her retirement function than I received in my my retirement function. So do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. Take the challenge of leadership. Take the challenge of leadership. It is wonderful to be a leader. And we need the touch of the woman touch in leadership. It brings in fresh air. It brings in different perspectives. And I'm sure that the wonderful changes will be made when we have more women leaders in any place, in any organization. So take the challenge of leadership. Now let me give you some small tips. Which is the best attire to wear to the office or wherever you're going? Make your guess. I would say this, any dress, but modesty is the key. Now let me tell you why. What you require is not visibles. What you require is respect. Please be aware of that and stay in your position. And when you are in a modest dress, that brings in, you know, otherwise I have heard many deriding comments from people on women who are not very modestly dressed. And our sari has a terrific advantage. When you are in a sari, it gets you, as ma'am, can I please be seated? Ma'am, can I get you something? This man will come Bhutsari only. It is something that happens. Do not ask me why, but it gets you bad. So, in a formal meeting, a formal function, when you are going to have a serious meeting, a client or someone serious, it helps. It's up to you. I'm not specifying that you have to do that, but I'm just pointing out some advantages that I have noticed. What is your best accessory? A Coach or Gucci bag, or a Tanishq diamond, single diamond or cluster diamond or whatever that you would like to wear, or a high stilettos that increases your height? Which would you say is your best accessory? A nice dress along with all this? I would say that your best accessory is this. A smile, yes. This is, believe me, this is your sharpest weapon. Nothing will match this. While engaging a client or giving a criticism, this is one thing that will save your day. I will say, practice this, consciously practice this. This not only enhances your beauty, it will boost your career as well. In a man's world, whatever it is at the moment, this is a man's world or a big jungle or whatever you want to call it. If you need to make your career through that, if you need to pilot yourself, the biggest accessory that you will have is the smile. Because if you don't smile, you just see what will be the effect on the other side. So keep this, keep smiling. That is very, very important. I come to the close of our what I wanted to talk to you. We quickly summarize. It is all about you. Your dreams, your situation, your priorities, your decision. Let's quickly go through what we discussed. We discussed about how important is your husband in your life. We talked about the backup that you require at home. You decide how much you want to go, and that you need to make a careful assessment before you decide what you want to do. But ultimately, it is all about you. It's your dreams. It's your situation, your priorities, especially what is your priority. You decide your priorities, and then you take your decision, and that will be your correct decision. And I end my seminar here. You can contact me at this Gmail if you have any further questions. At any time, I'll be happy to help you out. Now we open for any questions. If you have any questions, please come in. I can close. So then, thank you so much. If you have no questions, I have one last slide. How do I put that? In our beautiful language, Konkani, there is a part which says, it is one language which says thank you and God bless you in the same way. Devarekaru and God bless you and all your dear ones. Thank you so much.